The story of the House of David has fascinated the minds of millions for over a century. It was a place in Michigan that was surrounded in mystery, religion, romance, baseball, travel, sex, scandal, and huge wealth. It was all based on a religious colony that called themselves the House of David. Their leader and founder, Benjamin Purnell, preached that if you followed him, you would have eternal life of the body and live forever on earth. Converts traveled to Benton Harbor, Michigan from all over the world to be a part of this colony and see for themselves what was being touted as paradise on earth. Many spoke of the feeling of being at the gates of heaven as they arrived to trumpets and bands playing. Everyone in beautiful attire, magnificent horses and carriages, opulent mansions to call home. The new members gave up all worldly possessions in exchange for everlasting life, and the House of David grew and grew. What began in early 1903 as a new and exciting Christian faith soon became so much more. In this film, we will explore and chronicle the rise and fall of the House of David and the efforts to preserve its history and legacy. This is The House of David, Life Everlasting. The House of David had holdings all over the world, but one of the most important was an island in the middle of northern Lake Michigan. Ben saw the opportunities that came with the lumber industry and knew the power he had behind the members of the colony.
Ben bought a place called High Island back, I think about 1909, and it's a 2,600-acre island out in the middle of Lake Michigan, just past Beaver Island. There's three islands, Hassel Island, Beaver Island, and High Island, off the coast of Charlevoix. And he bought the island because he wanted to get into the exotic timber business. Because Michigan was the leading state, leading place in America for really high-end furniture, mainly because of the Grand Rapids furniture industry. High Island was known to have amazing virgin timbers of exotic timbers that weren't grown anywhere else, especially to that size and that quality. I have the original deed that he had from High Island that I bought at auction. So he bought that island because there was a sawmill there already. And the island was inhabited by Native American Indians. And so when the House of David took over that island, they moved a lot of their really talented lumber guys there, and also their farmers, because you could grow, instead of growing a potato like that, you could grow a potato like that. And so the fruit industry was like off the hook, like Galapagos Island stuff. Mind blowing, right?
I made the mistake once upon a time. I had been invited to give a lecture, and they wanted to know what we should title it. I said, title it House of David Penal, Siberia of House of David. Well, I shouldn't have titled it that way, because obviously my lecture, if you listen to what I had to say, it was not a Siberia or a penal colony ever. But one of the people that was listening or not listening became very irate at the end. How can you do this? How can you call this a penal colony? All that kind of thing. But they had, as they bought that, the lumbering rights on that island, and that isn't their first attempt at that. They had already had a very profitable lumbering operation just north of Beulah, Michigan, on the mainland, shall we say. But that had petered out. A cedar forest had petered out. They were looking for more. 1912, they get the lumbering rights, and they bought 80 acres of land outright there on the colony, on the island. They, since the initial logging or people up there to start some logging, there was an old sawmill there that they renovated and got everything going, and they will make that a profitable business. By 1914, that is a profitable business. They even had their own steamship that they had purchased to haul lumber back and forth.
And so they sent these groups of guys on their cruise ships, the Rising Sun and the Morning Star would sail, and even Roosevelt, which is a tall sail ship that the House of David had at the time. They would send their people up there to work on High Island and run these sawmills, and they had cabins that they stayed in. They had a schoolhouse that they kept their kids educated. And the Native American Indians that were on High Island had traditionally hated the white man and sabotaged what they tried to do on High Island. They embraced the House of David as the holy man. So somehow the House of David got the point across that we're not going to harm you, we're going to help you. And so the Native Americans that were on High Island actually gave their labor free to the House of David. House of David in turn taught the Indian kids in the schools and taught them about God. And so it was a beautiful thing.
They first went to school in the church, but then together, the natives and the Israelites built a small school next to the church. And natives went to school there along with the House of David young people almost always. And I think always. I never had a report of a young Israelite woman going to school there. In fact, of people that did not want to go to the island, as you can imagine, young teenage girls did not want to go to that island. There were a few young girls that had gone, and some girls went up on a visit at times, ostensibly for a vacation, but that, of course, gets debated too. So it was usually young boys. And then the school they had went up to the eighth grade.
The people back home at the House of David Park or the House of David Farms, if they got a little bit unruly or they didn't follow the rules, strict guidelines, they would get a warning. Well, maybe they would get two warnings. And then at the second warning or the third warning, they go, okay, you're going to get on the cruise ship. You're going to get on the Rising Sun, and you're going to go to High Island, and you're not going to come off. That's it. You don't come off. There's 60 miles of water between High Island and the mainland. So it's, the media call it the Siberia, Michigan. I interviewed people that lived on High Island with the House of David, and they said it was like a paradise. They loved it. So it wasn't really a penal colony in a way. I mean, it was a way to discipline people, but they ended up loving life.
One of the most cherished possessions that I ever received was from Melvin Tucker. In talking with Melvin Tucker in the rest home that the City of David had right there on their grounds, Melvin Tucker gave me a Christmas card, which was about a 2-inch by 1-inch card, just a little card, Christmas card that was given to him by his teacher in that one room school.
But it was a disciplinary island, so you got sent up there, and if you wanted to eat, you had to work. You didn't get to eat for just standing around. They would make you work, and then you would earn your keep at night. And that went on. I mean, there's stories. There's definitely stories in history that I've discovered that there was a number of females that got sent to High Island because they were pregnant. And of course, that wasn't supposed to happen. And then the coroner report of Charlevoix County would say this girl died of eating poison mushrooms. I'm not quite sure about all that dark part that happened up there, but it did happen. You know, those people, they were sent there to not come home. And there's fascinating stories that Ramon Nelson told me that wrote the book called Island Life, Island Toil. And he loved it there. He lived there. And then he came home, I think, maybe late teens, early 20s. And he said that every winter, there was two boys assigned to, when the lake froze over, every winter there was two boys assigned to go out and take cut off little pine trees and plant like a path, like Hansel and Gretel. So they would dig holes in the ice and they'd plant these pine trees so they would have a visual to get over to get the mail. And they would go, their job was to go get the mail in Charlevoix and bring it back to the House of David. And he said there was a few times that those boys, the blizzards would hit unexpectedly. How do you know? You don't have a weather channel back then. So they're on their walk or their run or whatever sled to get the mail in the mainland, and they would not come back. They'd disappear. So he said, sometimes we didn't know if they chose to not come back or maybe they hit the train and they left and didn't come back, because I have stories of that too. Or they just got blown away and lost and out on Lake Michigan and never to be found again. After Ben's death, they shut down, and so they pulled all the people back to the House of David, and it sat there for quite a number of years. And then in 1953, a guy by the name of Warren Townsend, him and his father had this mammoth furniture industry in Grand Rapids, making really beautiful, elaborate furniture. They bought the island from the House of David. I interviewed Warren Townsend, and I have it all documented, the whole story. Thank God, the guy was even alive. He was in his 80s when I called him, and the son. And he said, Chris, it was an unbelievable story. And we bought the island for really cheap. The House of David just wanted their money back. There was a beautiful sawmill there. And he said, we started there working, getting the exotic timbers. It was very grown up. He said, but the Indians hated us. And they hated us, and they told us to go home. And we bought the island for the reason of the lumber. And he said they didn't want us there, so they sabotaged our sawmill and burned it down, burned it down to the ground. So he said we paid to have a state-of-the-art sawmill built on the mainland, and it floated it over and installed the new sawmill a couple years later on High Island. And guess what? They burned it down again. And he said after that, we were like, we're done. We donated it to the DNR, and that's where it sits to this day. So, I had people come in just 2 weeks ago. I don't know if you saw it, but a guy had gone to High Island a lot of years ago. And still the big docks where the steamships would pull in to load the lumber, the docks, the pieces of the dock were still there. All the dwellings were gone. But around the dwellings were still, like, the daffodils still come up around the outside of the houses, and the flowers still come up on the trails through the woods. But there's no buildings. But he said that they found this huge spike where they built the dock, the steamship dock, from, and he donated it to the museum. So if you go there, it's just a deserted island now, but there is definitely evidence of life there at one time.